Welcome to our Good Friday celebration service. We are actually celebrating tonight Jesus' last words from the cross. Really, we're remembering how what didn't in any measure look like a good day truly was a good day for us. But tonight we're going to be focusing on Jesus' last words, and the last words spoken by anyone facing death tell a lot about them, about their character, about their heart, about what matters most to them. And Jesus' last words are no different. In fact, they're actually incredibly clear for what he's going through. They're incredibly thoughtful and gracious, not what you would expect for someone who's been unjustly condemned to suffer a brutal death. Consider also that he was suffering the most agonizing death known to men, crucifixion. It makes his words even more powerful. Tonight we're going to meditate on each of those phrases one by one and take some time to think about it in different ways. We'll have a time of worship, a little time of worship in the middle and a longer time at the end for us to respond to. But I just want to encourage you to fully engage tonight. Listen, think, pray as we're walking through these final words of Christ. The first of his last words from the cross were remarkable. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." It's a really simple first statement, but Jesus is praying for you, for all of us. He's praying for our forgiveness. But notice that he's not praying or seeking vindication for all the wrongs done to him. He's not praying for his own deliverance, but he's praying for forgiveness of his accusers, of his executioners, of everybody who is shouting, "Crucify him." See, most of the Jewish religious leaders didn't know what they were doing when they were calling for the crucifixion of the Messiah. They didn't know that he was the Messiah. Pilate and the Roman soldiers didn't know that they were executing the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. And the crowd who chanted "Crucify" didn't know that the very one that they condemned to die was the innocent one who set Barabbas free, and he would be the innocent one who would set them free. The very basis of his petition, his prayer, is they do not know what they are doing. We may not like to admit it, but we're fairly ignorant to the full dimensions of our wrongdoing, of our sin. Our sins are bigger, heavier, more costly than we have ever conceived. What we do, the good and the bad, is of incredible consequence to God. He measures it. But not only that, recognize the fact how sin separates you from God. Even if you are a believer in Jesus Christ, it draws you away from intimate fellowship with him. It separates you from knowing him deeper. In fact, it actually says in Scripture that we are enemies of God because of our sin. And so when he's saying, "Father, forgive them," he's speaking to his enemies. He's speaking to us. And we have to realize then, our sin is what held him there. And it's no small matter. Often we rationalize our sin away. We like to think, "Well, I'm not hurting anybody." But if you look to the cross, that's not the case. There Jesus is, the innocent Lamb of God taking the punishment that our sins deserve so that we might be pardoned, we might be declared innocent. And yet, pardoning doesn't seem to fully fit the whole weight of what he did. Not only did he pardon our crimes against God, but he wiped them clean. The whole history of wrongs. He expunged them from the eternal record with his own blood. And through his death, he set us free from slavery to sin. We never have to go back to the old way of living before, the ignorant, foolish way, when we didn't know what we were doing before. We don't have to go back to that anymore. He set us free to live in real relationship with him. Jesus taught his disciples to also pray a prayer of forgiveness. He was an example of prayer. He demonstrated it to them time and time again. But do you remember, he encouraged them to pray for others, to forgive them their sins, just as God forgives us our sins against him. Let's follow his example. I want to encourage you to take just a moment to meditate on this truth, to remember what he has done for us, to remember what he has forgiven you of. Just take a moment in silent prayer. Jesus, that you have fully and completely forgiven us, even though we didn't know what we were doing. We love you, Lord. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
They led three of us on a death march to the place of the skull, Golgotha, just outside the city. I'd never felt such shame and dread before. Yet I knew this is what I deserved. I've broken many laws, each to a varying degree. But now they've caught me. This was my personal judgment day. There was another criminal just like me, who I've had dealings with in the past. He's just as bad as me, if not worse. Then there's this other guy, dressed up like some mockery of a king, but beaten and bloodied beyond recognition. I heard he was the famous rabbi and miracle worker, Jesus of Nazareth. I even heard talk that he might be the Messiah. Those Romans were efficient. It felt like I blinked, and all three of us were nailed and hoisted up on those crosses. I could barely breathe. My friend was muttering curses under his breath, but Jesus? He was praying for everyone. He said, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." Do you believe that? Who does that? This guy was just so different. I noticed that they put a sign written in a bunch of languages saying, "This is the King of the Jews." I don't think the Jewish leaders liked that very much. People were hurling insults at Jesus, and my fellow criminal decided to join in, perhaps to turn any attention away from him. He had the audacity to say, "Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us." How could he say that? If this is the Messiah who he claims and is dying, doesn't he deserve more respect? So I said, "Don't you fear, God, since you're under the same sentence. We're punished justly. We're getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong." It was just so clear that Jesus was no ordinary man. He wasn't just innocent. He was better than good. He's the divine king. So I said to him, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And I couldn't believe what he said next. Jesus answered me, truly, I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise. Paradise! Can you believe it? A criminal like me in paradise? I hoped I might find some way here. Oh, yeah. He was just as good as his promise. I'm in paradise. Hallelujah.
When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to her, "Woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." From that time on, the disciple took her into his home. Jesus is always concerned about others, in this case, his mother. He's a faithful son. At the same time, Jesus is creating the new covenant community, an expanded family that transcends all the normal bonds of blood and kinship. That family is the church to which this congregation belongs. Jesus addresses his mother as woman. A bit of distancing is going on here, no doubt painful for Mary. At the wedding in Cana, Jesus says, "Woman, what have you to do with me?" Mary says, "Do whatever he tells you." The way to get things done, especially if you're aiming for joy and blessing, is do whatever Jesus says. Who are the true mother and brothers of Jesus? Those who hear God's word and put it into practice. Jesus takes the place of all his disciples and the whole world on the cross. He turns to one of the disciples and sets him in his own place as the son of Jesus' mother, establishing a new community right there at the foot of the cross.
This is a newer song with little familiar lyrics mixed in. So as you feel comfortable, please join us in singing.
You bled your heart out. Now I feel love beat in my chest. How wonderful! You gave your beauty in exchange for my ugliness. How wonderful! You lived your perfection. With joy and real peace. How wonderful! You left your perfection. Yes, Jesus loves me. This is love, you gave yourself. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. How wonderful, yes. Jesus loves me. This is love, you gave yourself.
About 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Matthew 27:46. It was high noon, but the sun refused to shine. Some say to show God's displeasure. Some say the whole cosmos joined in grief. Or we could think of the darkness as an opportunity for God to go to work in a hidden way, as on Mount Sinai, in the midst of the smoke and the thick darkness. But there's yet another way to think of this deep darkness. When God is absent, the lights go out. Jesus is working in a hidden way in the darkness. It's hard work, arduous labor, hammer and nails, bone and flesh, blood, sweat, and tears, and pain, agonizing pain. Jesus is paying the high price, his own blood, for my sins, for your sins, for the sins of the world. My God, before it was Father, again a distancing, this time between Father and Son. Jesus felt the gap that opened up between them. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us. 2 Corinthians 5:21.
The fifth word or phrase that Jesus spoke was, I thirst, or I am thirsty. When he says that he is thirsty, Jesus' humanity is seeping through as he suffers on the cross. Just the night before, he had gathered in the upper room with his disciples, and there he used certain symbols to communicate what was about to happen to him, the symbols of wine and bread. His body, like the bread, would be broken. His blood would be poured out unto God for the forgiveness of sins, almost like a drink offering. He told his disciples in that upper room that he would not drink of the fruit of the vine from now until the day when he drinks it anew with his disciples in his Father's kingdom. That seems like a far way off, and Jesus was true to his word. He was offered the sting of wine vinegar, a cheap, non-refreshing, pain-dulling, mixed with gall slurry. But he did not drink of the fruit of the vine, untainted, pure wine. And he won't do so until a special day, which is yet to come, when he is in his Father's kingdom and we are gathered there with him. This is going to be fulfilled, friends, at a joyous occasion. This is going to be fulfilled at the wedding feast of the Lamb. It's going to be a brilliant celebration. You know, in that upper room before he was crucified, he was preparing his disciples. He was telling them, this is going to happen, and I'm not going to get to drink of this again until he comes again. And he established what we have come to know as the ordinance of communion. And it's been passed from generation of believers to the next generation of believers as a regular ritual thing that we do together as a body of Christ to remember what he did through these symbolic elements. And we're going to take part in that together in just a little bit. And this communion celebration is for everybody who believes in Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. But again, as I said, these are symbols of what he had done. That his body was broken and his blood was poured out. This is symbols and almost a foreshadowing of the love feast that we are yet to take part of in his presence forevermore. And so I encourage you to take out your communion cups right now and first peel back that clear cellophane wrapper on the top, and you can pull out the wafer. And then after you're done with that, there's the purple foil. Very gently pull that back just enough so you can get the juice out. These are the symbols that we use today to remember what he's done. And by the way, if you're watching online one way or the other, I encourage you to get those out, and we'll take these together. You see, when Jesus was in the upper room and he was gathered with his disciples, he took the bread and blessed it, and he broke it, and he said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and he said, this cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink of it in remembrance of me, for whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Lord, we look forward to the day when you come again. We look forward to sharing with you in that wedding feast, for us all to drink together of the richness of life eternal along with you. Lord, to be with you forever. What an awesome celebration that is. Until then, Lord, we thirst for your coming. We long to see you. And we love you, Lord Jesus. Amen. The sixth phrase that Jesus spoke from the cross was, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." You have to love when Jesus talks about his Father in such intimate terms. In fact, did you know that he uses the word Abba, which is almost like saying Daddy, Sir? It both bears respect and intimacy in the same phrase. And Jesus does this time and time again. And in this moment, he's very personally entrusting himself to his Abba Father's hands, his incredibly strong and mighty hands. In Mark 12:36, Jesus actually taught his disciples to pray using this word, Abba Father. In the great, wonderful Lord's Prayer, Our Father. If you really understand that prayer and understand the words behind it, you know that it is a prayer of surrender. It's a prayer giving ourselves fully to God, committing that God's will would be done in my life as it is in heaven, which in heaven, you know, the angels snap to. They do God's will as he commands it in that moment without delay. And so we're submitting to that desire, but we're also then trusting him with our provision of our daily bread, for our protection from the evil one, for deliverance from temptation. We are entirely entrusting ourselves to him in every way. There's another place where Jesus prayed to his Abba Father. It was in the Garden of Gethsemane. That's where Jesus prayed, "Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done." Is there any greater surrender than those few words? He's about to face the cross, and he prays, "God, let your will be done, not my own." And as he nears the finish line, he surrenders once more, committing his spirit into God's hands. Maybe your parents, like mine, taught me to pray the prayer, "Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take." If you really slow down and think about that prayer, it's a little bit creepy. It is. It was born out of a real fear that children may die in the middle of the night. They may fall asleep and not wake up again. And yet on the same end, you can also see within this is another entrusting of our lives into God's hands, his mighty, powerful hands as his child. And you know what? I think that is a prayer that we can say no matter how old we are. We can always further trust Jesus and the Father with our lives. He knows what he's doing. We can find our refuge in him. And God, if we come to him and surrender all to him, he'll always love and accept us as his children on the basis and the sake of his Son. Always. Always. The final word that Jesus spoke is tetelestai. In the Greek, it doesn't mean a lot to you, but it means it is finished. This is the last word, which is appropriate and fitting to be the last word, the period at the end of the sentence. These are the final words of Christ from the cross. But what is he finishing? What is he saying is finished? I am finished. My job that I came in the flesh to do is finished. It's crazy to think, isn't it, that the same baby that we celebrate at Christmas is then the adult Jesus who's hanging on the cross, who has gone through over 33 years of life and walked among other human beings, demonstrating who he is, teaching and leading people to know him better. And now his life, at least his physical life here on earth, is coming to an end. Of course, we also know that it's not really the end. It's not the final word. He breathed his final breath, and yes, his work is done. Salvation is considered complete. No one can add to his work, no one can take away from it, and no one even needs to try. We can only rest in his work. So when he says it is finished, we rest in his work. We stop trying to earn our salvation. We stop trying to be good enough, smart enough, skilled enough to earn his love. We trust that what he did counts for us. He has proven his work is complete and his love is fulfilled on the cross. And so now it's up to us to simply trust him and praise him for what he's done. His forgiveness is full. All of your sins are covered by the blood of Jesus on the cross. Your past, present, and future sins are covered. Hallelujah. It is finished on the cross. And yet every ending is another beginning. If you have trusted that it is finished, then you know that your eternal life started that moment when you trusted him as your Lord and Savior. And it's going to start now, and it's going to last forever. And so it's not over for you. Even when your life is over, it's not over because of Jesus' finished work. You can live now with confidence and joy and peace because Jesus declared, it is finished. Jesus' seven sayings from the cross are powerful. They are so powerful. Not just because he was dying in our place, but because we know this wasn't the end. He died on the cross, but 3 days later, he rose again. Hallelujah. We're going to continue to worship him, the resurrected Lord, and remember what he did on the cross. We invite you to worship along with us.
If you're able, if you want to stand and join us, we're just going to spend some time in worship, in reflection of what we learned tonight.
Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Me. Darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. you silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus. And I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. 'Cause Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Lord, now still repeat, 'cause Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised his life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who my dead and raise his life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raise his life up from the dead. 'Cause Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a
We just want to thank you for joining us for this special time of reflection, of time in his word, and thinking about Jesus' last words, some of his most significant words. I pray that they've spoken to your heart. I pray that you've been challenged in how you think about Jesus even a little bit more. And I pray this prepares you for what's coming. We want to invite you for our Easter Sunday services. They'll be at the regular service times, 9:15 and 11. We'd love to celebrate his resurrection with you there, because just as Good Friday is a celebration of his death in our place, Sunday, Easter Sunday, is the day we celebrate the fact that he didn't stay in the grave. He is alive today, and he lives to ever intercede and pray for us. But right now, let's even go to him in prayer, because he also promised that we could, in his name, ask for anything. And so let's go to him right now in prayer. Will you pray with me? Oh, Jesus, We are amazed and in awe of what you spoke from the cross. It goes beyond the natural to supernatural. What you said speaks so much of who you are and what you value. And thank you for speaking forgiveness to us through the cross. Thank you for speaking your confidence to us that you care also for families and for life to go on. And thank you that we can count that in you, the work of salvation is finished. That we can rest in that truth. That you have accomplished what no religious leader, no other philosopher, no other anybody could, not even ourselves. And you saved us by taking the punishment that our sins deserve on the cross. And so, Lord, we put our trust, we put our faith, we put our hope in you. As we go from here, God, continue to speak to our hearts and challenge us in this. Open our hearts and minds to understand and to love you more. Thank you so much for loving us so amazingly to be willing to go to the cross. We love you, Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen. God bless you guys, and we'll see you Sunday.